very pleased today to have Zana Zarich with us. She's a philosopher, a political philosopher, and a moral philosopher. She's at the École Normale Supérieure, ENS, in Paris, in the philosophy department of École Normale Supérieure. And among other things, she's a graduate of the American University of Paris. She did her master's at the American University of Paris, and she's currently finishing her PhD in political and moral philosophy at the École Normale Supérieure on compassion and politics. That's not the title of your thesis. What is the title of your thesis?
It's still a working title. It's the political significance of compassion.
The political significance of compassion. So, Ms. Zarich is a cosmopolitan philosopher, theorist, and she has presented some texts here. She has led over the past year a seminar at the Hospital Hôtel Dieu on care and compassion with other philosophers that brings together medical practitioners, philosophers, psychoanalysts, sociologists, social scientists, in a seminar on the question of care and compassion in the polis, in the city. So, in the cité. So, I'm very pleased to have you with us here today to extend the discussion we've already begun in this class on the question of cosmopolitanism and cosmopolitan hospitality. So, please welcome our guest speaker.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for preparing for the class. I hope you like the readings. And most of all, thank you, Professor Dodd.
Pleasure.
I hope for you it was as an important experience as it was for me and my friends, my colleagues from my generation. I graduated from here 2 years ago, I think now. And we all unanimously agreed at the end when we did our finals that the class that has changed us the most was precisely this one, because we were forced to think. Even at times when we didn't want to or wanted to give a simple answer, avoid thinking about the subject, we were, I don't know if he still does that to you, he would always ask us to define ourselves, whether we're liberal, realist thinkers, cosmopolitan thinkers, and then to be able to argue for one position or the other. And that kind of push to critical thinking is precisely what cosmopolitanism is, to say it in a very simple way, but if that's all it is. It doesn't presume a creation of a world state. It just asks us to think for ourselves and to think outside of the boundaries that we have, the boundaries of nation, race, or gender. So to me, it's really a great honor and privilege to be able to be at the ending of your class, where I assume you spoke a lot about already the social contract, the other frameworks, and to kind of end it on an optimistic note, which I believe is cosmopolitanism, because it gives a vision. And this vision might be criticized for being idealistic or just a normative frontier, but like often in sociology, for example, that's all it takes sometimes. If we aim for it, we're always on the right path. So recently, I stumbled upon a movie I saw a long time ago. I don't know if anybody has seen it here, La Haine, which means the hate. It's a Matthew Kasowitz movie with Vincent Cassel. And the movie starts with an interesting anecdote I wanted to share with you, because it's related to what I'm saying about cosmopolitanism as a vision. It's the story of a man who falls from a 50-story building, and as he's falling, he keeps telling himself, until now it's all good, until now it's all good, until now it's all good. And then as he's finishing the story, one of the people telling it says to the others, what matters isn't the fall, it's the landing. Or in French it would be, c'est pas la chute, c'est l'atterrissage. So the fact that we're always going to fall or go astray in politics or in our personal choices isn't what's most important. What's most important is where that road is taking us. Because as we see, unfortunately, today, the choices that are extreme nationalists and populists precisely lack vision. They are the immediate responses to urgency, to terror, and they're not thought through. They don't have a vision of what they're proposing, what they're leading to, what kind of a better world would that be if we only adhere to that policy. So the case I'm trying to argue with compassion and with cosmopolitanism and compassion in my thesis is precisely that that is the political framework that can help us think the world differently. And before I start, I wanted to ask you all if you have an idea or a definition of what cosmopolitanism is for you, or whether you see it differently now after these two readings. I've picked them because this is what we read in this class when I was here in my master's degree, and this is one of the authors I'm using the most in my thesis.
Well, actually, you were in the graduate class.
Yes, in the graduate class. But it was also philosophical foundation. So, you were saying earlier that you felt that Appia is contradicting.
Mm-hmm. Just in the sense that like there's this one passage in her argument where she talks about like if we prioritize human life, like we would have like a really dreary existence. And then she goes on to talk about like human slavery and how many Americans wouldn't like take pride in like our cultural progresses if we had tried to fix slavery in the beginning. And I thought that was just such an interesting, kind of like shocking argument, which she does address, but I didn't really understand her point there.
He addresses it again later with the example, I don't know if you got to that part, where it's Kwame Anthony Appiah, yeah? And Martha Nussbaum is the other one, if you're talking about kindness to strangers.
Exactly.
Yeah. So he says also, if you buy an author ticket that's pricey, should we instead be thinking how many lives we could have helped with the price of that author ticket? And that we are not supposed to live our lives that way, that it's not something that should be imposed as a thought, because he's arguing against Singer and another thinker that write that precisely what the example you're using is we cannot think of a world that where the only thing that's important is saving lives. We cannot envision living life in such ways. So therefore, doing or not doing good, the maximum good with the amount of money spent isn't the way to think of it. Later he gives an example of, for example, saving the lives of children where dying from diarrhea in Africa by sending them clean water or food. But if their lives continue in the same misery and if they're still living in the same problem, then we're not really helping them, we're just prolonging their misery, versus having a cosmopolitan approach that's thought through about how do we fix the institutions around them, how do we help their families get out of poverty, how do we enable them, versus these short-term fixes. So not just seeing the suffering body, but seeing a human life that's in this way lost, the dignity of a human life. It is always contradicting cosmopolitanism in that way, but that's why it's always just an exercise for us to think of the world differently. I hope that answers some of it.
Yeah.
Anybody else has any thoughts or where you are so far with cosmopolitan theory? No? Okay. So it's a very old idea that dates from 4th century, the 4th century BC and the Stoics. And the first person to claim himself a cosmopolitan was Diogenes, which is mentioned in these texts. And it comes from the Greek, from two Greek words, kosmopolitis, which literally means city and world, the citizen of the world. And this is this idea that we might inhabit a realm beyond our own particular nations has reemerged at various points throughout history. And I believe it is reemerging with particular saliency in the 21st century. Because if Diogenes was able to argue for being a citizen of the world and feeling equally obligated towards people who he has never seen or encountered, in today's world where we see the rest of the world constantly, where we have digital technology, where we have travel, where we have open markets, it is impossible to argue that we didn't know that argument doesn't work anymore. And therefore, the fact that we are living in an increasingly globalized and interdependent world puts compassion into on the scene again, and I think I keep saying compassion whenever I want to say cosmopolitanism. It's because of the work that I've done in my thesis. But I'll show you later that they actually work together. So I believe that cosmopolitanism has an important role today in an era of digital technologies and globalization, and it plays a role in the way we see us, the way we see the role of the individual in this globalized world. And I think you all would agree with me that more and more of us are finding it very limiting to just be defined as a French, an American, a Serbian, an Italian, because we can choose to live in another country, to be educated in another system, and we can think the world, hopefully, as cosmopolitan. This is something that, in these two texts, Martha Nussbaum addresses as, I think, concentric circles. where she says that precisely because we have different identities, it is normal that the familiar ones, the close ones to us, are those that we're going to maybe give more importance to. And she talks about giving an expensive education to her daughter and not being able to do the same for all children. It doesn't make her not a cosmopolitan. So in no way do cosmopolitans say that patriotism isn't important and local allegiances aren't important. They just say that our first belonging is to humankind. And this is where cosmopolitanism joins my thesis. It is based on the idea that we all have these different allegiances, but we only have one that we all share. There's only, absolutely only one that none of us can say that we don't share, and that's the fact that we are all mortal and all vulnerable in different degrees. So precisely because of being able to recognize that, we should be able to act in ways that address first and foremost that, and then in second, third, fourth, other places, all our other belongings. Compassion meets the cosmopolitan theory and in general the place of emotions in politics is the idea that where do our moral acts stem from? Where does this need and want to help the other come from? Why don't we just live in a completely individualized manner and only look for our own best interests? It is precisely because we know, we feel that this can happen to us as well. Aristotle argues that when we see another human being suffering, if we see the suffering as partially or fully not the fault of the person, if we see that the damage is serious, and if we see that it could potentially happen to us, this is what mobilizes the feelings of compassion and belonging to the human self. And Martha Nussbaum argues in other books, she wrote a really important book on how to form the citizen of the 21st century, that this is precisely what we need to use to form global citizens. She argues the case for compassion versus, for example, other emotions like empathy, because she says that compassion has thought in it. It's not devoid of thought, even though it's naturally human. And later, I'll tell you about other authors who argue that in the state of nature before the social contract, there wasn't only self-interest. But even though it is natural to us, there is the problem of not educating it, of not promoting it, of not mobilizing it. For example, we can all agree that certain fictions have been really well mobilized. Like, we have the fiction of a state. What is a state exactly? There is no address, no door, no one to speak to that is the state. For example, in France, that's the idea of the hexagon. There's a flag, there's colors, there's a national anthem. It's very, it evokes a lot of things and passions. And therefore it's easily mobilized, whereas mobilizing the idea of belonging to the same mortal humankind makes it a lot more complicated, or maybe I argue my thesis is just that it hasn't been done as much. So we are used to certain mobilization of fictions and to certain not as much, but why it's important to think of it through the lens of compassion is you will also find if ever you read Jean-Marc Rousseau, who wrote Emile or On Education, which is the ideal child and the ideal way to educate this child. And he addresses different stages since birth to adulthood. And he speaks about, at one point, which is interesting in an international relations context, of the types of, he uses the word PTA, it can either be translated as pity or compassion, the types that are dependent on the social contract. He argues that before the social contract, in the state of nature, humans were not only oriented for their self-interest, like we've seen with Fox, for example, that man is wolf to man, and that we will only want to have predator tendencies toward the other, but on the contrary, that we will also help when it does nothing for us. And then there's the other type of compassion that is changed because of social contract and institutions, and therefore it is something that we need to educate, we need to know. Both of the authors you've read also argue for the importance of imagination in this education. For example, literature, movies. If we are able to imagine distant lives that we don't share anything in common with, that we haven't been in touch with, if we are able, when we read a book, when we watch a movie, to empathize with somebody who might not have ever crossed our mind, we are better armed to respond in a situation if we ever encounter a situation like that in our lives. So to quote Hannah Arendt, she said, storytelling reveals meaning without committing the error of defining it. which is again something that could help define cosmopolitanism. It doesn't look for a specific definition of right or wrong. It just asks us to respect diversity in a non-hierarchical way. So by knowing diversity, by learning more about the differences, we are able to recognize what's in common, and that takes us back to what I was saying about the shared mortality and vulnerability. So why I talked about emotions here a little bit is to say that there are a lot of authors who argue that our moral intuition is often more of a secure option than the principles that we will appeal to in explaining them later. This could be the argument, for example, between Schopenhauer and Hume versus Kant. I'm sure you've talked about Immanuel Kant already and his principles. The categorical imperative, for example. Just one typical example to take. If we say that lying is never good, that we cannot lie, and there is a situation during the occupation, Nazi occupation, where you're hiding Jewish children in your home, and a Nazi officer comes to your home and asks, are you hiding Jewish children? If you say yes, is that being morally good? Is that following the categorical imperative? Or is saying no, because you don't owe that truth to that Nazi officer? It's not him who detains the right to that truth, because his doings are not truthful, are not right. So I take this example to just show that our allegiance, again, first and foremost, this case proves, is to the humankind. It's not to a mere form of government, it's not to a temporary context we live in, because those, as we've seen, can often lead to catastrophic events. And if we use our agency, our freedom to think, to explore, to write, to criticize, we keep creating constantly a climate that is a climate for cosmopolitanism that allow us to get out of these impasses that our lives can often end up in. Another thing I wanted to share with you is something we often heard in Professor Golub's class when I was at AUP, is that and it's been mentioned in both these readings, is that the place of birth is merely an accident. So if you are born a little bit above this border, you're American, under, you're Mexican, it changes your life completely. But it's not something you're responsible for, and therefore, how have we come to be so accustomed to that being so defining of our lives and our choices? Both these authors and many others suggest that we should start thinking outside of individual boundaries to be able to live a fully cosmopolitan life. Another reason why the nation state shouldn't be the only way of conceptualizing good and bad or limiting our actions is, of course, another problem we end up with is when we have scarce resources like we do, we know they're not infinite. Often you will have political leaders create a discourse of us and them precisely to be able to rule with these scarce resources. A typical example is where I come from and falling apart at the end of the Yugoslav Republic. When the market fell down and the economy was destroyed, it was easy for these ethnic entrepreneurs to come in and to use the us against them. You have to do this to protect that. You mobilize nationalism and patriotism for its worst, and we see where that ends. Where mobilizing cosmopolitanism cannot have a dangerous side effect, if I may say it that way, as other ideologies has. Precisely because it's not an ideology, it's an ideal. It's a normative frontier that we should all aim towards. Another thing I wanted to share with you is this reimagining and the emphasis on the world, the word imagining, of political community. I believe that there's a lot of work to be done precisely on imagination in today's world, because if we are able to see with our phones, with social media at any moment, what a person of our age is doing at any other part of the world, what does that do to our imagination of the place we are physically in if we can at any moment be virtually elsewhere? What is our boundary in these different situations that we're living right now? So I like to believe that our limits are not defined just in a negative way negative freedom, in the sense that ours stops where the other person starts. That limit isn't just something restraining, it's also enriching. It's the creation of our own individuality. That we shouldn't be thinking ourselves only in the context of neoliberal ideals that we're autonomous, we're independent, we don't need the other, we're not vulnerable, because that is just not true. And thinking that way creates a lot of frustration in relation to solution in today's society. So thinking that the more compassionate we are, the more armed with imagination, and thinking in a critical, cosmopolitan way, the better we are to respond in situations that are emerging in this different, interconnected, globalized world. And therefore that this is what protects us precisely, that this boundary found through the need of the other, through paying attention to the diversity of other, is what will help us live fuller lives. So this thought through and contextualized, being well thought through and contextualized, is cosmopolitan. So it is compassion as well, because it is the context that matters. It's the ever-changing circumstances of this world that matter and the emphasis we put on them. That's why I also put them to work together. And I was thinking about this earlier, that we can put an emotion to each framework of international relations, for example. We can say that that liberalism is maybe defined by tolerance or pity, because we will say we live in a multicultural society, we live next to something or someone we don't understand, but it is the way it is, and we tolerate it. Or we can say we live in a cosmopolitan society, and we try to understand the difference, precisely to live truly together versus just living next to. And then, of course, realism and the ideas of just egoistic self-interest. So I think it's interesting, maybe, at the ending of this semester, as you're writing your term papers, to think about these frameworks, not only through theory, but also through emotions that mobilize them. Because it's inherently human, it's impossible to ignore to say that we only make rational, calculated choices. They're also very dependent on how we feel in the world. So to create this climate in which things like that are happening today don't happen to all of us, we all need to speak out, to write, to create. It is not a goal for a world government, like I've said before, and cosmopolitan theorists argue, very few will say maybe a world government is needed, but none of them want to reproduce a nation state on a global level. None of them say that that would be a good idea, because they say that same state could easily become totalitarian or would disregard the local. So it's not just another creation of something else in itself, it's more in NGOs, in advocacy groups, in our own agency and engagement. It's thinking that what cosmopolitanism means intelligence, curiosity, courage, and engagement in outside our nation state and our used to belongings. There is a thing that I really like that Martha Nussbaum writes in one of her books, where she says that it would be understandable that we have these tendencies, like a child who loves and trusts his parents, to reconstruct citizenship along the same lines, to create an idealized image of the nation as a surrogate parent, a parent who will do one's thinking for one. So that seems like a lovely, warm, cozy image a child would want to reproduce. But the danger of that is if we're again delegating the thinking to someone else, where is the social contract in that? It is a Leviathan in a different way, in a surrogate, maybe loving parent who we cannot guarantee will be like that forever. So again, giving away our agency is what leads to dangers that cosmopolitan theorists are trying to fight against. Again, I'm quoting Hannah Arendt. She says, the ideal subject of totalitarian rule is not the convinced Nazi or the dedicated communist, but people for whom the distinction between fact and fiction, true and false, no longer exists. And maybe an interesting thought to leave you with in a post-truth society and the alternate facts we live in today. Thanks for your attention. I hope there's a lot of questions.
Well, let me start.
Questions.
What do you do with the problem? You, as representative of cosmopolitan theory here today, what do you do with the problem of that Appian brings up, that also Nussbaum brings up, that everyone brings up, which is that although one might agree with you in the abstract that allegiances, that we have a first belonging, as you called it, a first belonging, and that our primary allegiance must be to the one thing that unifies all human beings, which is our understanding of our own mortality, and therefore the need for us to be cooperative and in solidarity with each other, how do you deal with the problem that in fact, as history, sociology, the social sciences show, all of this, that our actual commitments, allegiances, our commitments, are strongest when they are closer. What do we do? How do we deal with that? That our commitments to family, then our commitments to, particularly to family first, and then beyond the family to the group that we might be part of. It can be an ethnic group, it can be a religious group, it can be any kind of group of which the family is, in which the family is inserted. And then, of course, the nation state. But as you move towards the nation state, we've discussed this in this class, you're already moving to an abstraction, to an imagined community. The family is not an imagined community, is it? It's an organic unit, even if it's not always harmonious. It's an organic unit, right? How do we deal with that in cosmopolitan theory? How do you deal with that, with the fact that your allegiances are so much stronger, so much more intense, and therefore our understanding of compassion, more than empathy, compassion and common shared fate, expresses itself much more powerfully in that local context rather than in the universal context. How do we actually move from the local to the universal?
I wish I had an answer that's a definite answer to that question, but I think that is the hardest question for all cosmopolitan theorists, because precisely it dissipates the feeling of compassion or belonging or attachment as we move across the local, the national border. Like the example that Appiah gives, a Chinaman in China and a Chinaman that's living in our state one day. What happens when the Chinaman magically crosses that boundary and lives with us in our state, then we start caring for him. I personally, it is my opinion, I believe that this is all the result of the mobilization of these fictions and the use of our imagination. It will always be the case, I also believe, that family is our primary allegiance in a way. Primary allegiance, what I was saying, to humankind, of course, but primary in the way that we can actually act to protect, to serve. And then, like you were saying, there will be others, religious or local. But maybe already the first step would be to transcend the prevalence of the nation, as that you are more responsible to your an American citizen, in your case, or a French, than you are to an Italian one that you might randomly encounter somewhere else in this world. So I think already mobilizing education, cosmopolitan education, like Martha Nussbaum argues in America, to give more salience to lives outside the United States, to show American children that they're equally full of diversity and interesting and important, is a way of opening up to that world. Because if our imagination is limited, like it so often is in most countries, I'm only taking America as an example because Nussbaum does, to what is local, and we give a very small percentage of attention in educating the global, then we cannot expect from people to empathize or have compassion for something that they're not familiar with. Aristotle has also argued we need the familiarity at least in the perceived proximity or the idea that it could have happened to us as well. And then you have the opposite, where Rousseau argued that, for example, a king will never be able to feel compassion or empathy for the people he governs, because he thinks he will never be in the same situation. So maybe realizing and constantly mobilizing that idea that we can and all will be vulnerable at some point in our lives, or someone dear to us, that someone will be sick, someone will have an accident, someone will die, is universal to all of us. Is the only thing that's universal, and that we can understand suffering across border could help. I don't think it's the complete answer to the question, but I think it's precisely in mobilizing the ideas of vulnerability that are normal and inherent to us, and not what neoliberalism tendencies do to completely avoid it. If you look at any dictionary of moral philosophy nowadays, you will have 10 entries on autonomy and not a single one on vulnerability. So if we try to shift that focus from the ideal of the human being being defined in how productive we are, how autonomous we are, how independent we are, and in promoting, for example, only positions that make money, and we start promoting positions also that care and help and protect, we can already start changing that balance. That's what I would suggest.
Okay, and second question, I mean, I may come back to that. And the second question I would have is this, is that how do we get beyond the inevitable fact of social stratification? Rousseau's argument is a strong argument, that the king feels no compassion, not because it's a particular king, but because of the position of kingship, or oligarchy, or aristocracy, or just social hierarchy in general, that those who are at the top of the social hierarchy, having reinvented their position in the hierarchy as stemming from merit rather than chance, will inevitably have very little compassion for those who seem to have less merit, and certainly much less chance. I mean, there's in American Psycho, the novel, I didn't see the movie, in the novel, there's this absolutely horrific but violently neoliberal scene where the banker is coming down. They've just had a cocaine party and they have all kinds of stuff is going on, and the banker comes out of the morning, he's a financier, what kind of governor, and he sees a beggar in the street, and he begins pretending to talk to the beggar, and then finally takes his eye out. As, you know, by which the Ellis was showing the acute violence of autonomy, neoliberalism, and things of this type. Huh? How to deal with the problem of hierarchy, of social hierarchy, and of the struggles for power, profit, and prestige that are inscribed within social hierarchy? Is it enough to call upon the vulnerability of all to actually change the way in which social structure shapes worldviews, or not? So, I know these are difficult, I'm not sure one can answer this, actually, but that's the point of our dialogue, so.
So I think in the example you gave, which is the most radical and drastic example of not giving equal worth to all human beings, and to how far we can go from that. Again, I come back to the same answer. I believe that it is the most horrific consequence of pure capitalistic neoliberal orientations of lives. So our lives are oriented since school. Today, education is very competitive. The workplace, evaluation, profit, and constant accumulation of goods. This is something that for a number of years now has been the only discourse we hear through media. We must not forget the power of media and education in forming our consciousness. So if this is the predominant, if we feel less worthy, if we're not productive, if we're not making much money, if we choose an option, like for example, it was my case, I used to be a lawyer, I chose to teach. If I choose to teach and I make far less money than I make as a lawyer, then by the standards of today's world, I'm less worthy. So if we refuse to accept that confiscation of reality, first and foremost, I think that is the most important answer to all questions, not to allow our reality to be defined by someone or something else, to be always aware. That is the only active citizen for me. The only citizen with actual agency is the one that doesn't just accept what is served and can actually start thinking in different ways, and then if we all start thinking in those different ways, this can actually change. It seems like such a radical and drastic example that you gave that it's too far, it's too late. But I believe it isn't, and that it's never too late, that the only moment when it becomes very dangerous is the moment where we precisely decide we give someone else the power to think for us. So if in today's world we see all the problems, we see the 21st century have more anxieties and depression and suicide than any other time before, than times of wars and hunger and world wars, and people had more hope, people had something they were going towards. They knew that this was going to end and they're getting somewhere. And today we don't know when it ends or how it ends or what is our goal. And this is precisely what creates these kinds of anxieties, and everyone for themselves, and we're all just accumulating goods, thinking we're protecting ourselves that way. We're alienated from the other, already with the surface, the digital technology services in the street, in the subway, you can look, everybody's doing this, nobody actually looks at the person in the street. So all of these tendencies is something I believe is all our own individual work, to stop thinking in such a way, to just stop going in the direction of the system, and hopefully the role of media and intellectuals to criticize it as well, and why the emphasis on vulnerability, because all of this, once we encounter the point, the wall, where we see we can't keep going like this, some sort of an anxiety disorder or an illness or stress-related problems, we don't have an answer. Nobody tells us it's okay. It's human. It's because you're vulnerable. It's fine. Everybody else is like this. Everybody else has this. No, because we see role models in media, that don't have this. We only see what's best, what works, what's productive. So I believe that this has created a world of a center and a periphery. The center being the world that we highly value, a banker, a CEO, and we have a periphery, caregivers, caretakers, nurses, I could say even doctors have less and less importance. So this center and periphery creates an illusion of what's important in the world and what we will choose. And if at an early stage a child in education choices will choose those that are more lucrative versus those that can do more good, is the first thing we need to make a break to get to what we're hoping off of our community.
Okay, one may or may not be satisfied with that answer, but yes, thank you. Please.
When you're talking about the example you just gave, but for example, if you're feeling bad and there's somebody in the street and they tell you, well, vulnerable, and you know, so everybody has these problems, etc. I'm wondering how that would go with when you start taking into considerations of the struggles that different communities or minorities face, and also when you look at like a board and you're looking at a post-colonial world, and we're looking at different communities, how can you, it seems really reductionist to see it being as simple as saying we all have the same struggles, or we all have the same problems, without taking into consideration the different positions these people might be in order to create like a fully cosmopolitan world where we can all have a life that only leads to the human kind.
But what you said is absolutely the right approach. It's what we had, for example, that happened last summer, I believe, with the slogan Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter versus All Lives Matter. All Lives Matter. To address what is obviously not equal is the priority. Like you said, it's not the same in a post-colonial situation or in contexts where a certain ethnicity has been underprivileged. You cannot say all lives matter. That's precisely why Judith Butler argued for Black Lives Matter, because we cannot close our eyes to the fact that being born white and male is probably the best option. So until we get to the point where our vulnerabilities are equally relevant, we need to first address those, is what I believe would be my answer, and I believe it stays within the Kofi-Boughton framework, because in no way does it say that there's no hierarchy of vulnerability. It doesn't say that if you're having a bad day because of a class and you walk out in the street and you see somebody who is homeless, that at that moment maybe it will actually be your compassion that will allow you to realize your problem isn't that big, isn't that relevant, because you see and can potentially address the problems of someone else that are far greater. That, for me and my thesis, is a part of the moral philosophy work I'm trying to do on compassion and how it allows us precisely to form a sort of hierarchy of urgency of needs and problems versus a hierarchy of nations and branches.
I have another question. Why compassion and not empathy?
That's a question I get all the time, and my favorite one. So empathy, well, there's a lot of authors that will say empathy and not compassion, and those that will say compassion and not empathy, but I'm coming to the conclusion that is based on what's more personal, what's more political. So empathy, you have a lot of works in psychology that show is developed in the early stages of an infant's life, that until the age of two, an infant has this thing called the global empathy, where it will cry if another person is crying or somebody is yelling. It will feel distressed, like some harm is happening literally to him or her. And at the age of two, somewhere around the age of two, it develops egoistic empathy, which is the empathy where he can still empathize if healthy, if in a healthy environment where he's shown how to do that with the other, but he's aware that it's somebody else suffering. That he no longer feels that he himself is a danger, but that there's somebody else's, that somebody else's danger is near, or somebody else's suffering, and therefore, this stage is the stage where usually we have studies on psychopaths and today terrorists, where there's been some sort of trauma, something happened at this age that certain individuals no longer have the ability to empathize with others if they themselves weren't cared for at this crucial period of development. And so you could argue that empathy is something that's more personal, that's more dependent on a loving environment, on a good enough mother. And compassion is something that has thought, like Nussbaum argues. She says that even though it's biological, it's not devoid of thought. And I've argued to, for a rational case, there's a professor, Professor Bloom from Columbia, who recently published a book against empathy, a rational case for compassion, precisely trying to argue that if we are going to make a choice before, between what instantly mobilizes our emotion and the greater good, that's doing and thinking and acting compassionately. And there were studies done to show that if we have $5 and we watch certain videos to choose where we donate those $5, and we see a story of this one little girl who has lost her parents, who lives in a war-ridden country, and we see an NGO explaining how much good they do with certain percentage of money for this particular group, most people gave money to the little girl. And they could do a lot more good with helping the NGO. They could have used those $5 to help more people than just one. So that is the problem why I'm making compassion, the reason why I'm making compassion political, is to argue that we shouldn't just be led by the emotion of the moment, like the images that are served in media, but we should think it through, again, coming back to cosmopolitanism, have a critical attitude towards it, and then act in a global way, which I think is the whole point of cosmopolitanism, to think of ourselves constantly throughout our lives as a citizen of the world, and to act in ways we can best do the greater good, versus just thinking that our obligations stop at some sort of boundary.
Compassion then would be more authoritative, more a more worked up positioning in the world.
We might say it starts with empathy and then the thought helps it. And it has the active part, which most emotions maybe don't have, which makes it more like a virtue than an emotion. Mm. Makes it like virtue ethics, something we can work on to make ourselves better.
Thank you. Firstly, I have a question that I'm going to put under the theme of the moral imposition of cosmopolitanism, and I'm going to make a sacrificial example, so I'm afraid to get attributed this year. But it goes back to Appiah. His sort of dance around what can we demand of ourselves, and what's reasonable, what isn't at all. And taking from the point that it seems unfair to demand of someone who's still working on their basic Maslow hierarchy, food, shelter, water, to develop a bit more globalized or a bit more dissipated boundary view of themselves and the other. So it seems a little bit unfair to demand that, just as a gut instinct. But my question comes to the example of the housewife. For example, of someone who has all the resources to be able to reflect and expand their worldview, but still chooses to actively not engage. And it's the, on page 168, he says, cosmopolitanism, it's a sentence that's not important to turn to, but it says, cosmopolitanism is about intelligence and curiosity as well as engagement. So my question would be, would a housewife who has the resources to engage and reason and tap into this compassion, who is raising children and actively deciding to deny them of a cosmopolitan education, would cosmopolitanism blame them in a certain way, hold them accountable for their housewives, again, sacrificial example, hold them accountable for their lack of expanding the viewpoint, or would you perhaps... What I fear is, when you're speaking about imagination, I fear that it gets into saying, well, this person who chooses to be a housewife suffers from a lack of imagination. So So I'm wondering what your thoughts on that are and what can we demand of someone's rationality?
That's a great question, thank you. The very beginning when you were saying that it's, I think it's two questions. I'll answer the same questions. I'll attend to the housewife second. At the very beginning when you were saying that we cannot ask from someone who's still working on their basic needs to help others, that it isn't fair. I would agree with that, but then again, there are a lot of cases, and maybe more, that prove the opposite, that we have this theorizing of societies as the post-materialistic ones, when we have enough to live well and comfortable, that we start thinking about the environment, about recycling, and maybe some societies that are not there yet can't even think about that. And it might be ridiculous to tell them to when they're still just thinking about how to feed their children. So even we've seen the cases of societies that have not gotten to the post-materialistic values yet, that those were the societies typically helping the most. In the refugee crisis, we've seen Greek families that themselves are in poverty, helping and bringing meals a lot more than somebody who is a lot more alienated from that position. So that's debatable, I think. And for the housewife, I have to think about it a lot. I think it's a very interesting exercise. Is it the education system that has failed her and her development of imagination? Or is it when we have all the choice that that she is not making the greater good choice but the egoistic choice, or you haven't said exactly how she would be raising those children and what she would be doing for herself in her free time? So then that's the debate again, is a human being naturally good or are we naturally egoistic? I think it only puts us back in those questionings. And the only thing that I would propose as a change in that is the failure of education, which is the moment where whatever education she received wasn't cosmopolitan enough. I don't think it's a very satisfying answer to the second part of your question, maybe Professor Mullen can have a better one.
Yeah, my question would follow up in the first part, intriguing the idea of people who, like the idea that people have less when have more. I absolutely agree. I'm speaking more so in the sense of our first instinct is that, they're excused in a certain sense. I'm not saying I agree, but
I understood.
Yeah, but it's interesting because in that, to throw the idea out, if you're talking about someone who hasn't necessarily developed fully into a post-materialistic, as you say, society, I wonder if you can almost consider it that infancy, that universal sympathy, right? If the infancy in the capitalistic world. I'm going to throw that idea out there. The second would get back to, and I guess as you say, about the moral nature of humans. I'm scared if we start talking about the failure of education, if we also get into the idea that there's something essential about human beings. And it's what you say, mortality seems to be the essential trait of being alive. But I'm wondering if we say that education has failed, does that mean that there's something that is tapped into a bull in everyone then?
I believe so, and I believe that is the compassion and the imagination. It has not failed, it has entirely failed. It has completely succeeded in the national boundary way. In all of our schools, we have learned so much about our nation state and so little about others, in some countries more and some less, that it leads to these situations that I'm referring to as the failure of education. Mm-hmm. But the tapping into, I believe, is tapping into the compassion in all of us, that I believe is biological and there in every human being. That it just maybe isn't mobilized enough, isn't valued enough in society for that to be something that we address, to be something that we value, that to be something that we think could do to do us any good.
Thank you.
You wanted to ask something, Rebecca?
I was just going to ask, if you thought that the growth in cosmopolitan thought and it's spread throughout the world, if that's synonymous with a form of empowerment, just because the history of cosmopolitanism, one would think of elitism, somebody who can travel, somebody who's been able to learn several languages, and now because of media, we have an available wealth of resources.
Yeah, that's actually excellent. That's something that I want to read. That's precisely what you were just saying. I wanted to ask at the beginning what the word means for you. And here a Brazilian author writes, the description cosmopolitan evokes a lifestyle that is enlightened, urban and worldly, one able to navigate, as you said, the languages, tastes, and cultures of the world's great cities with ease and panache. For many Americans, the work conjures up images of Helen Gurley Brown's ideal of the independent, liberated cosmo-woman of the 70s, an image reinvented for the 90s in the wildly successful Sex and the City, and its celebration of girl talk over... Yes, I'm quoting Sex and the City. think martini-like drinks known as the Cosmopolitan. So yes, there could be that remark referring to it as elitist is something that we can only attain that kind of thought once we have already lived in societies that are successful enough, post materialistic enough, developed enough that we get to that. But then again, it all comes back to education, that in no matter what kind of state we live in and level of development, if we start educating about the world, the differences, diversities in a non-hierarchical way, and vulnerability and mortality of all of us, that changes. That doesn't become something elitist so that only a few attain.
TNT, in the philosophy department, L'École Normale Supérieure, Zona Zaric is one of the people who's worked on this issue from the standpoint of compassion, but the whole department is working, or many different departments are working in the same direction. The head of the program, Marc Crepon, has just published a book, which is not yet translated,
the
is
murder
it?
Murder of Consent, not yet translated
in English. Yeah, Murderous Consent would be the English translation of that, where he investigates the question. I don't think it's fully solved, the question, but it's important that he's investigating it. He investigates the question of our acceptance, of de facto acceptance or explicit acceptance of words that kill and acts that then kill. Murderous consent is a kind of consent that we give our consent by not acting, by not acting to certain kinds, and by not thinking it through, and by not taking appropriate both moral and political action on it, that we are consenting to things which are not morally acceptable from the standpoint of a foundational cosmopolitan morality. And in a recent talk, what he pointed to was the problem of violence. I think it's interesting to think about this, that the way in which violence at various levels, the violence of war, obviously, but also lesser levels of violence, the way in which violence permeates society, our societies, and our de facto acceptance of the fact that our societies are like that. We say, well, that's the way things are. Human beings are like that. But there's violence in society. And what he argues is an effort, a conscious intellectual effort, to abolish violence. Now that's as utopian, of course, as Mrs. Zaric's effort to get cosmopolitanism as the primary agenda. I say this provocatively, but I'm torn about these issues. I always have been. I'm a torn cosmopolitan in a certain kind of way because of my understanding of social structures and political realism and things of this type. Not political realism in international relations theory, but political realism more generally. The problem is that in enunciating statements about what should be, we are not necessarily saying what can be. So the normative frontier doesn't necessarily coincide with what is actually possible. And if the normative frontier does not coincide with what is actually possible, aren't we just back then into the problem of the classical problem of idealist political philosophy, which is that the idea is here, and there's the world there.
Yes, and then he gives four suggestions of how it could not be just idealism, and I gave some of my attempts to make it more practical. First of all, the definition of what he calls the consentement pié, or the murderous consent, is the fact that we live in this space, which is between the theoretical ideals, which we could say are Kant's, and the practical possibilities that we can help. We cannot save all of world starving children, but maybe we can do something for someone here and there and around us and wherever we're at this at a particular time. So because we live in that kind of gap, that doesn't make us inherently bad or guilty. That is just the fact of our existence. And what Professor Gall was saying about what should, what is, what we accept to be, what could be, is what I always refer to as the confiscation of reality. If we take to believe that, for example, we constantly see an unmeasured amount of violence on our television. Whenever we turn on the news, we know that there's going to be some sort of violence. A natural disaster, a war, we're bombarded with these images, even though in today's world there's a lot less violence than there ever was. We don't have that impression at all. And I believe that that is used to precisely make us dizzy.
Desensitize us
to say that, well, it's so prevalent, it's so, it is everywhere, it's omnipotent, there's nothing I can do about it. What can I do about it? It's constant, it's all the time. Even if we just did something good, look, it's still here, it's still happening. So that's the role of the media and those that want to confiscate the definition of our reality. And then there's the free thinking of cosmopolitanism to see actually where and how we can best act. Max Ripon, my thesis director, in his book suggests that there are four possible ways of addressing this that are at the same time the four proofs that there is a joint humanity and that there is a cosmopolitan nation, a global citizen. He says that it's just a first step, it's already enough to experience the feeling of shame. If we are ashamed when we see how badly the governments have responded to the refugee crisis, if we feel ashamed to be human, when we see war and suffering and hunger and dying of innocents, just the feeling proves that there is something joint, that there is this joint humanity that is proven by us experiencing shame. Then there is critique. Us as intellectuals, journalists, professors, media, it's everybody's role to write against it and to denounce it. Whenever we see it, some false, alternate fact, post-truth, confiscation of reality, we are not supposed to just ignore it, laugh about it, we have to write about it, speak out about it. Therefore, we are creating a climate that is a climate that will help cosmopolitanism grow versus fear-mongering, symbols, all kinds of things. And then there is revolution, which of course cannot be expected from anyone and everyone at any time, but it's a response in an organized way to what we are against. And then there is the simplest one, which he calls bonté. I translate it as goodness, as just being good and kind and random acts of kindness as wherever we can find ourselves to be to help others. So those four at the same time give possible ways of getting out of the impasse of the theoretical ideal and the practical limited, and also the four proofs that there exists joint humanity and people who actually feel that we belong to something greater than our nation.
Okay.
Any other remarks, question?
In speaking about the mobilization of fiction, I think is one of the words you used. It's an interesting word because it both has negative and positive connotations. And I'm thinking, and you spoke about the mobilization of the fiction of the state. And I might say that yes, there is a state, but there are also what cosmopolitan might consider a positive fiction and negative fiction. Just say we definitely see today that there is a negative fiction being mobilized of, right, we all have an image of a terrorist because that fiction has been mobilized. It's an extremely decisive fiction. And my question would be, is the cosmopolitan approach the cosmopolitan fiction? I'm not sure sort of what, because it's hard to have an image of something that we don't have yet, that we don't see yet. We see examples of, but I'm wondering what would be a mobilizing fiction of that?
Is it a fiction, or what would be a mobilizing fiction, or both?
Both, then, if you ask.
Okay, yes. So how I got to this idea of fiction the first time, I gave a lecture on my thesis a year ago in Belgrade. And that I got a question that isn't all of that just fiction. And I quickly, I don't know how I managed to do that, defended myself by saying that the nation is also a fiction. Well, I owe that part partially to this class and Benedict Anderson and Imagine Communities and all that Professor Gallup gave us his readings. And I think the only difference is one is a fiction that has been really mobilized from education to media, and there's another fiction that is maybe there, more accessible, like you were saying, to the elites, maybe through culture, but it isn't imposed on us, it isn't valued, it isn't something that we are told is important and good, like we are told for the nation. So whether we see it in negative or positive terms of mobilizing fiction, for example, the best case study, and it's been written about so much, is when Yugoslavia fell apart. You had until yesterday all these people living as one, nobody ever evoking differences of religion or ethnicity, and defining themselves as Yugoslav. And then you have the market down, media mobilizing nationalism and patriotism for the worst causes. And all of a sudden, the importance of being called Croatian, Bosnian, or Serbian, the importance of defining yourself by what you're not. So that would be obviously the negative fiction of really well successfully mobilized that it attained that goal. And there's so much fiction involved in war, and there isn't today in the war to take as an example, that works. It's again a fiction that works, whereas I don't know how much the fiction around cosmopolitanism works, because it's not present enough. In my own personal opinion, it's not present at all in schools or in some very rare different forms of education. And it's not present in the media, because the media is doing precisely the opposite, which is mobilizing fictions that make us constantly feel less and less safe and more in need of security. And then who will give us that security? That security can only be given by the state. But then nobody thinks about what happens when, for example, you're on the wrong side of the state, you're a refugee, you don't have a passport. Who gives the rights to people who are with no nation, with no nationality? Who's supposed to protect them? So to think outside of asking for that surrogate parent, like Nussbaum says, to think for us and protect us, what are the other ways we could protect just and give rights to the basic human allegiance, which is just being human, protect human wherever human is found. So if it's a border, a country, just to give basic dignity, which is another approach that's very important that Nussbaum did with Amartya Sen, who is a Nobel winning economist, which is the capabilities approach, where they try to explain that it's not the rights that matter the most. Having rights per se won't do anything in a tsunami earthquake-ridden society, that they can call themselves between male and female, that they have equal rights, equal pay, or whatever other standards that they've achieved, if they don't actually have access to them. Or to take examples of a lot less developed countries and societies where people might not even know that they have certain rights. They might not have information about them, access to them. They might not have enough knowledge about how to obtain them. So that this capabilities approach that they're trying to explain is actually giving basic human dignity, giving life value, not emptying it out of value by only helping when it's urgent. And a book that I just gave Professor Gallup, which is The End of Hospitality, written by two French philosophers, says precisely that, that hospitality isn't just reacting to the urgency, to saving a life. It's hospitality is
welcoming.
Fully, so it can develop into a human life that's not empty of value, that has dignity, that isn't just like sending a check to UNICEF to save children that die from diarrhea in Africa. Today they'll have water, tomorrow again they won't. We're not thinking in a cosmopolitan way of how we solve that problem.
You prefer fiction to narrative?
No.
As a word, as a concept?
They're both equally different. I believe they're very, very different. Fiction, narrative, and imagination, I would say they're all equally important but very different. Imagination in, for example, the choice of literature in schools and being able to empathize maybe with somebody who's seen as a bad guy or different in a movie will allow us to be better armed and more open to diversity in real life situation. Narrative, especially that comes from the people who govern us and the media. And then fiction, I believe, matters the way it's mobilized and the way we can mobilize it after we have used our imagination.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.